Turn off my phone. Hello, everybody. This is a continuation of the Board of Selectmen public meeting for Tuesday, November 1st, 2016. We'll continue with the Pledge of Allegiance, please.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
So we began this evening in executive session where we took a look at some minutes. We were in executive session to discuss contract negotiations, litigation, and real property, some of it specific to public safety personnel, and some of it specific to fire and dispatch unions. At this time, we'll ask if there's anyone here that would like to address the board, share their opinions, ideas, or ask questions regarding their town government. Anybody here that wants to say hello? Seeing no takers, we'll move right along. Is that the chief I see back there in his casual attire? The police chief, not the fire chief. Fire chief is well dressed.
His nation is incognito.
Oh, that's right. We're not supposed to know he's here. Okay. At this time, though, I would like to ask Fire Chief Steve Slammon to join us at our guest table and make a presentation specific to the fire department. Chief Slammon, welcome.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me in this evening. It's with great pride and honor that I bring forward to you a letter from Police Chief Doug Wyman out of New Hampshire. I received this recently. It's for an action that actually occurred early in the summer, but it was such a unique and special letter that I just wanted to share it with the board. I think I'm going to start off by just to frame it. Firefighters have a code of ethics that they follow, and just a little bit of a background, if I could read to you for 1 minute.
Sure.
On that code. This is out of the National Fire Academy. It talks about ethics comes from the Greek word ethos, meaning character. Character is not necessarily defined by how a person behaves when conditions are optimal and life is good. It is easy to take the high road when the path is paved and the obstacles are few or non-existent. Character is also defined by decisions made under pressure, when no one is looking, when the road contains landmines and the way is obscured. As members of the fire service, we share a responsibility to project an ethical character of professionalism, integrity, passion, loyalty, and honesty in all that we do all of the time. And I just, as I go into this story, I just want you to think about that from this code of ethics that the firefighters go with. So here's a letter I got from Chief Douglas Wyman. He started off with, in regards, commendation of Lieutenant Carl Harris, Fire Prevention Officer Thomas Poirier. Dear Chief Slammon, I am writing to you to inform you of the exemplary conduct of the two firefighters at an incident that occurred in Sandwich. I had to take a couple of pieces out just for privacy, but I'm going to try to give you most of the facts. Sandwich Police and fire departments received a 911 call to the area. The caller reported that there was a man running around in the roadway naked and appeared to have physical issues or experiencing a drug overdose. The caller stated that the man was highly agitated and aggressive. I arrived on scene and encountered the individual, who started toward me but then flopped himself on the ground, banging his head off the pavement to the point where I thought he had rendered himself unconscious. As I approached him, he suddenly got up to his feet and came at me in an aggressive manner. I discharged my taser into the individual, but the taser had no effect. The subject then charged me and grabbed me about the shoulders, and we began to struggle and grapple. I managed to dry stun him with the taser again and again, having no effect. The struggle continued. Suddenly I heard, "Chief, we're behind you and are here to help." It was Lieutenant Harris and Fire Prevention Officer Poirier. These two men had been out for a motorcycle ride with their friends and families at the time and had by sheer coincidence stumbled onto this situation. Lieutenant Harris grabbed hold of the man's arm. Fire Prevention Officer Poirier grabbed at the legs. Together we placed the subject on the ground where I was able to handcuff him. Harris and Poirier then stayed with me and assisted me in restraining this person until backup and an ambulance arrived, which was another 5 minutes. Your firefighters are to be commended for their willingness to become involved in assisting police officers in a violent struggle and placing themselves in harm's way. They were a great assistance in the subduing of the person, who was later taken to a hospital and then transferred to a county jail, where he was charged with the following offenses: simple assault on a police officer, resisting arrest, disorderly conduct, and indecent exposure, and lewdness. I also wanted to commend your department for your training. It was a great relief that they announced themselves when they entered the fray, so that I knew that they were there and wanted to help and not attack as approaching me from behind. He just concluded, had your firefighters not chosen to become involved and assist, the outcome could have potentially been very different. So with that, obviously I had the pride and honor of that letter. I'd like to ask Carl and Tom to come up. And what I'm trying to do with the board is just in recognition. Gentlemen. Of Lieutenant Harris and Fire Prevention Poirier for the actions of bravery while off duty that exemplifies what our firefighters represent while both serving our community and living their daily lives. Thank you.
Thank you, Chief. Thank you, gentlemen. Thank you for being there that day. Thank you for making Hopkinton proud. Job well done, and I'm glad everybody's safe. That's great. Thank you so much. Chief, thanks for coming in tonight.
What a great story.
Okay. Let's see if we can follow that one up. Sorry? Oh, thank you. Okay, we have our consent agenda next. The board will consider appointing election workers, appointing 5 election workers with terms that expire at the end of the annual town election 2017. The board will consider signing deeds conveying a legacy farm municipal parcel on Wilson Street, 21 acres, and a recreational parcel on East Main Street, 19 acres, to the town. And we have some minutes from 10:25:16. Does anybody want to break anything out in the consent agenda? Hearing none, the chair will entertain a motion to approve the consent agenda as submitted.
So moved. Second.
Any discussion on the motion? All those in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposed? Thank you. So now that that's passed, we're going to, the election worker will take care of the Legacy Farms deeds. Will we be signing those this evening? Yep. The Legacy Farms deeds, is that something we'll be signing this evening?
Yes.
Okay. All right, just so everybody knows at the end of the meeting. Good. Okay, item number 4. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving a livery limo license for Easy Car Boston LLC to operate a livery vehicle to transport passengers around Hopkinton to and from Logan Airport in Boston, Mass. Mr. Kamalo.
This is a standard request to the board.
No. Yes.
Is that on? Yeah. Do we have someone here to represent the company? Please join
us.
Thank you.
Yeah. This is a standard request to the board. We did circulate the application to permitting offices and received no objections.
Okay. Does anybody have any questions for the applicant specific to this request?
Just clarification, you're basically providing a taxi type service so that Hopkinton residents have someone they can call for primarily local transport, and then there's your Logan aspect, which is a separate piece of it.
Yes, exactly.
Okay.
So. Are you just dealing with one vehicle?
At the moment, yes, just one.
Okay, so
if the demand increases and
takes off, there are plans to expand. The area where the vehicle is going to be garage stored, is it in a residential neighborhood?
Yes.
And I guess, Mr. Kamala, what are the regulations in terms of how big something can get before that would have to change?
Yes, I think the general standard is making the decision that it's no longer a home-based business and requires a different location. And at that point, the building inspector will communicate with you.
Is there any kind of guideline or precedent that we have out there for this type of business to say, okay, this is no longer home-based? Is it once there are other employees?
There's some guidance in the zoning bylaw as far as what the business has to entail.
Okay. Assuming this passes tonight, you know, let's just make sure we communicate them so that he knows.
Anybody else? Anybody want to make a motion?
Make a motion to approve the
livery limo license from Easy Car to operate a livery vehicle to transport passengers around Hopkinton to and from Logan Airport, and that we provide the required documentation that he needs from us to make this happen.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Mr. Kamala, you good with the motion?
Perfect motion. Thank you.
Good practice.
Okay. You okay with that motion?
Perfect, yeah.
Okay.
Good luck.
All those in favor?
Aye.
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 Any opposed?
Thank you.
All set. Thank you. Okay, next up is item number 5. We have it slotted for 7:15 p.m. It's a change of manager at the Cornell's Irish Pub location. I don't see the applicants here at this time, so I think we should table that. Mr. Kamala, oh, that's right. We're gonna table to another day?
Yes.
Okay. So we're going to table it entirely for this evening, so we can take that off the agenda. Item number 6 is the Irvine Todaro Properties Advisory Group status update. Mr. Catino, is this something you want to table for a little bit till others arrive, or do you want to try and do it now?
No, that's
right. Are we ready to go?
Yes.
Okay, excellent. So please join us if you could introduce yourself to the folks at home and give us an update on the Irvine Todaro property, please.
Hello, Alton Chen, 3 Nicholas Road, chairman of Irvine Todaro Property Group, Property Advisory Group.
Great, welcome.
So the intent of this meeting is that the Irvine Todaro Group was tasked upon roughly 12 months ago to identify the uses of the property, create a development plan, and provide assessment and recommendations to the Board of Selectmen. Additionally, we're tasked with communicating with and towards the citizens of the community and conducting public outreach. To give perspective of the Irvine Todaro property, it's located on Route 85, south of EMC Park, and relatively near to the school campus. The Irvine Todaro property is named as such because of the previous owners of those properties. The total property encompasses roughly 52.5 acres, and the new elementary school building will be going on the Irvine property, which is on the north side, but south of EMC. This is another view. It's a little bit outdated, but it gives a perspective of where the elementary school will be located, and gives perspective of the remaining space. The blue marks are indications of wetlands, which the school building committee has built built around or created workarounds.
Are those buildings current?
Yes.
Those are current?
Yes. This picture is roughly a year old.
And you're showing the school just above and to the east of those blue areas in that sketch, correct?
That's correct. This is not the final view of the school, but this is rolled to give indication of where the school will go relative to the total property.
Great.
So what we've done to outreach into the community is we distributed a survey from August 11th through September 23rd, promoted through several avenues, including town website, Hot News, The Independent, and also through Facebook. Promoted at PolyArts in September, which has another forum for public outreach. Overall, we received 265 responses. And we are looking at additional opportunities for outreach to be determined on when and how. So we are aware that the 265 responses may not indicate a full cross-section of the community, given that we have over 16,000 citizens and roughly 10,000 voting participants. But what the survey did indicate is that of those respondents, they indicated favorability towards future school and favorability towards trails. There was low favorability unfavorability towards school bus parking. Keep in mind that the survey did not provide, it was fairly high level, so it did not go into the benefits of excise tax or providing information of the commute of the school buses from Ashland currently. It was just, are you in favor and what is your perspective? There was lack of support for sports fields on the property, and we additionally received feedback from the school committee with a letter so that they could document their perspective of five key uses that they would be interested in. Those encompass bus parking lot, maintenance facility, school building, cross-country courses, and administrative office space. They do want to clarify that there was no time perspective on their potential uses, and we're not saying that they want to see that for the next 6 months or the next year. It was more to put perspective on it. This is a visual of four of the survey results. So with one being least favorable, four being most favorable. So it gives a visual of the trails, parking lot, school, and sports field. Also keeping in mind that there were no dollar amounts put in perspective on any of the questions. So overall, our recommendation is that we delay decisions until after the new elementary school is nearing completion, because at this point, we want to give the community time to gain better perspective of what the school needs relative to the property. Additionally, we do recommend proceeding with the parking lot to accommodate both school buses and trailhead parking, but it does appear that based on the respondents, and this is subjectively, that the community may need more information of the benefits of the school bus parking lot, perhaps a republication of last town meeting's information. And then also we recommend proceeding with trails, but with a limited investment. Certainly there's a wide range in what trails can be, all the way from the path around Whitehall to the Milford Upper Trails. So we're not putting a dollar amount relative to it. We have not done any research or survey about what trails encompasses. It's purely that the community encourages trails.
Great.
So that encompasses our selectman update.
Excellent. Thank you very much. I'm sure we're going to have a couple of questions, so if you just kind of hang in there for a few minutes, and I'll table mine until my colleagues have a chance. Mr. Tedstone.
The Irvine-Tadaro property.
pretty sure that the people that used to, there's a house there that used to be owned by the Flemings. Is there a reason, like I don't drive down that area very often past Chamberlain Street, but I was driving the other day and I took a quick look at it and everything's kind of in disarray. The grounds are not being mowed and the house is not being maintained.
So I'm not sure what the house reference is on the Flemings. Do you know the address number?
No.
Was that purchased with part of the land?
I'm pretty sure
yes.
That was.
So we
so it looks like that house is the only vacant house in the strip on that area that I'm aware of.
The pink one?
Nope. The house prior to the pink one as you're
white
towards
one.
North.
Okay.
Yeah.
Yes.
Oh. It's got the flagpole out front. So it looks like I know that building is probably a perfectly viable building to use for something for the town. Is there a reason why we haven't explored using, letting Parks and Rec store their footballs and basketballs there, or why we haven't, I don't know, it's been vacant, might be vacant and all the pipes have burst. I have no idea, but I know that in the past that building has been very structurally solid and is there a reason why we haven't? And I'm not asking you specifically, I'm just bringing this maybe to Norman or the board, because we haven't looked into utilizing that.
Through the chair, in fact, currently, Park and Rec is using the garage to store some of their equipment. Okay. Also, the fire department has been using the house and structure for some of their training. We did evaluate the viability of the house for any government or town hall uses, and based on the recommendations from facilities, we concluded that the structure was not suitable for occupation or habitation as is now.
So based on the suggestion from, who makes that suggestion from facilities?
Dave, in fact, toured the facility together with Jay, as well as I believe the chair of Park and Rec. The building inspector may have been with them. I need to verify that with Dave.
Abstractly, that we look for a lease here, for office space here. And at some point, maybe it's not Trump Tower, but it's probably a usable place for something or someone in the town to use. And to know that Parks and Rec's already probably using the garage is good. And to know that the fire department's training in there is good too. But if it's a really good structure to use it for some capacity for some department, I think we should explore that rather than just not turn the heat on this year and let the pipes burst and that's a complete loss and we have to tear it down.
So just jumping on that a little bit, if we own it and we're going to hold it for a while and look at what we might use it for in the interim, and this isn't to you, this is to us, to the town, in the interim we should maintain it, at least the exterior of it, so that it doesn't look like it's a depleted, house falling apart on one of the main drags coming into town. So if you could get with our team to figure out how to make that happen, that would be great. I'm sure the DPW can swing by there and zap that lawn like they do every other lawn.
I used to mow it, so I know the lawn inside and out.
Oh, there you go.
Perhaps Mr. Ted Stone could head down there on Saturday mornings, but we want to make sure it's official.
If I could just get a billing address, I'd be glad to do that. It's not going to be cheap, I'll tell you that right now.
Okay. Any other questions specific to the Irvine Todaro property? Mr. Sestari,
yeah.
I'll come back to Mr. Kamal.
My recollection, first of all, thanks for the presentation. It's great. I guess a couple of questions around this survey. When you were surveying people, my recollection of one of the things that our board is looking to get out of this group is ideas of temporary uses for this property, thinking that, we want to save it for a longer-term use that, who knows, we might find out about in 6 months, it might be 6 years, it might be 15 years. But in the meantime, we've purchased this asset, and we do want to put it to good use so that the town can benefit, since they're going to be paying for it. But we want that preliminary use to be something that will be easily reversed if we choose to reverse it so that we can do this other more long-term type thing. Has there been any discussion by the committee or research into different ideas for what we could do on a temporary basis?
No additional research in terms of short-term use. Our questions were encompassed within the survey. The survey included more than the four topics that were presented. But those were the largest that bubbled up.
Yeah. Okay. Great. Thank you.
Mrs. Wright.
Just clarification on the map that you have. There's a hatched area that's shown, I can't find it right now, says buildable space, that long, narrow portion. But then on the elementary school site, the lower parcel is also hatched. Is that part that's attached to the elementary school site spoken for relative to the school, or is that under discussion, or are we just talking about that long, narrow, buildable space parcel?
We are talking about all the space that the elementary school is not on.
So that hatched area that's on what looks like the elementary school parcel right now, that's also kind of up in the air.
That's correct.
Even though you have one labeled as buildable space on the narrow, it's actually that whole hatched area.
That's correct.
Okay. And just out of curiosity, the priority for a new school, we're just building a real state-of-the-art elementary school. What is the thinking looking forward as to what might next be needed for schools? I was thinking we were going to be in pretty good shape for quite a while. Is there something that's on the horizon as next in line?
Is the question for
it's kind of to open-ended to somebody. Is there another school need that we see coming up?
I think that the school that's being built right now is not going to have a lot of extra capacity versus what the projections are over the next, 5 years or so. I don't think the school committee is trying to, I've never heard them make any bid to say we need to build a new school and we need to start planning it now. But I think that when we started the purchasing process of these two lots, one of the things we were saying is we don't know 5 or 10 years from now if the population grows and, who knows, we may need a new school or we may need a new fire department or fire station, excuse me.
Might have been right.
We're trying to keep the options open. And so I don't think there's been any specific discussion around the school other than, when we talk about the town's population and all the different projects that are going on right now, if all of a sudden we have a bigger boom in population, then it's something we might need to consider.
Well, just my own input on that. I mean, I certainly understand need for other municipal facilities, perhaps fire, whatever. But, in terms of at a certain point, we'll need to kind of take a hard look at what are realistic school projections. Because I know looking at land use, and we've seen surveys of the remaining buildable, what's considered buildable land, and the remaining land is getting poor and poor. Most of the good land is gone, and every town's land has what they call build-out capacity. So somewhere along the line, we need to look at realistically how much more development, can the town realistically support? We can't have unlimited expansion because the land won't support it. So those are all factors to enter in. I was just wondering when I saw school, I was a little surprised because we've got quite a school project going on right now.
The build-out's a good point. I think the build-out in Hopkinton is 20 or 20,000 people. At capacity. Does that sound correct?
22 to 25, maybe?
22 to 25, so still a ways to go, possibly, if that's the number. When the land was purchased by town meeting and then at the ballot, there was some discussion at town meeting, well, what's the plan for it? I mean, this is kind of what we're doing now, is coming together. We had a plan for, obviously, the elementary school building and the Irvine piece, but what was the plan for the balance of it? The school bus parking lot was discussed at length at town meeting. And I think that is an opportunity, not just a need, but an opportunity. opportunity for the community to become more efficient in what we do with our tax dollars specific to transportation of the students. So the school committee is working on that. We're going to let them work on that. It's their job. It's their purview. It's their, you know, within their control. And we'll try to support that as best we can. I get that some of the folks in the survey didn't necessarily look for the parking lots to be a high priority for them. But that was a significant part of the discussion at town meeting when we purchased the land, so it becomes a high priority for the community. So, we'll
and again, that's something that could be there temporarily
as
well.
Yeah, I mean, that's a lot that you.
Yeah, in the discussions, it was around a gravel lot exactly.
Yeah, we're not talking striped and
That's right. I mean, there's varying levels of permanence that could be put down in terms of the parking lot.
Yeah.
Also, in terms going back to Claire's question of. School, when we talk of buildable land within the school campus, going back to the town meeting, was it 3 years ago when this property was being discussed, it was more that there's limited remaining available space if we want to maintain a school campus environment. So if we look at when Center School was outgrown, roughly every 30 years was when the additions were put on Center School. I don't know the growth rate of the town relative to the last 100 years, but if we look at buildable space, that property at least is retained by the town for that future growth.
To Mr. Sestari's point, some of the other things that were discussed is for the DPW for temporary storage. When they're resurfacing the streets and whatnot, they need a place to put the gravel that comes up, and also for maybe the residents' sand and salt at various times of the year. But again, those are just temporary things that
you run into an issue with DEP with salt and road grindings too.
But this is something that.
I think that the survey is helpful as we're looking longer term, because so that we try to prevent the rush to the trough, I guess, and all of a sudden everybody's trying to find the use that they can justify that'll use that land on a permanent basis, and whoever gets to us first, all of a sudden we hand it over. We don't want that to happen. Without at least some awareness of what the community is looking for out of that land as well. But in the meantime, I think that shorter-term use is something that we need to, we don't have to be in a rush, but I think that intensifying the search for that use isn't a bad thing either.
Yeah, I think the short-term recommendations, or at least the discussion points at this time coming out of the committee, make all the sense in the world based on what town meeting discussed. And based on what we discussed last week at our budget meeting with our friends in the school committee and appropriations committee and a debt service coming at us like a freight train. So, while we would like to maybe do some other projects in Hopkinton, I don't think the appetite's going to be there for several years to make anything happen. So the short term of the parking lot in a very sort of benign, simple, straightforward fashion makes all the sense based on what was discussed and what we need. But beyond that, I think it is time to sort of sit back and pay for what we've got before we take on new projects. And so we shouldn't rush to judgment on what those new projects are going to be.
Mm-hmm. I do think, though, that it might be good to kind of maintain a public ongoing running list of long-term land needs that the town can foresee that we can all look at and factor in whenever we're talking about a piece of land. You said there were a number of choices maybe on the survey, and what you listed were the top four. I don't know what else was available, but sometimes people aren't thinking of like the fire station needs or whatever. They just think in terms of, wouldn't it be great to have some more trails? And we should all, as a community, be keeping those needs. Yeah, those needs foremost in our thought when we ever look at a piece of land. So.
Okay. Anything else specific for Alton here and his team?
Yeah, just one thing. What I forgot to say, Alton, was that was a very well put together and comprehensive report. So I didn't mean to jump on you. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
I think it's very well done, very informative.
Thank you.
Okay. I can assure you, you've got more organized specific to this land study than a certain member of the board selectman who sits on the Pratt Farm Committee group because we are struggling with some issues over there. So you guys are way out ahead. So thank you very much.
Okay, thank you.
Any other questions? Mr. Kamala, you good?
I think I'm good. I'll ask the question offline.
Okay, yep. Thank you.
Yep. Thank you.
All right, thank you so much. Have a good night. Item number 7 on the agenda is a review of the draft master plan. And I'm going to ask Mr. Kamala to introduce this one to the board as well as the community. Mr. Kamala.
If I may, with your permission, I'll ask Elaine Lazarus to do the intro.
Excellent.
So our current master plan was done in 2007, and this is the update to that plan, the draft that you have before you. The Planning Board will be having a public hearing on November 21st to get public comment and comments from boards on this. It's very lengthy, so hope everyone has a chance to read through it. But it covers the requirements that state law has for planning boards to include in a master plan. So the subject matter is determined by state law. We can add additional things, but it covers all that's required in a master plan. So it goes through the towns and the planning board's plan for the physical growth and development of a community. So it's basically what it's about, and I think we're interested in your comments and passing them along to the board.
So Elaine started out talking about the master plan and our need to put something forward, and this is the draft of it. The master plan comes from, and correct me if I'm wrong, is written and drafted by the planning board.
It is.
Not the Board of Selectmen. And it's part of their charge to put this together and then sort of have it be a guide going forward as they look at projects coming before the community. Talking about build out, the number of people that can live in town, and the land use and so on. All that would be part of this master plan and the process to get it done, correct?
Yes, and although some of the recommendations will involve work to be done by other entities, open space, Upper Charles Trail, things like that.
Okay, great. Any thoughts or comments, questions for Elaine, or any discussion anybody wants to have specific to this master plan?
I printed it out and started reading it. It's like 60 pages long. So.
Yes. Yeah, when does the movie come out?
This is it.
Yeah. Oh, but if it was, my kids will tell you. They'll know. So you good for now, Mr. Tedstone?
Great for now.
Mr. Catino?
I'm good. That's part of it.
All set? Mr. Sestari?
I have not had a chance to look at it, so I don't have any questions at this point.
Mrs. Ray?
Well, I haven't read every word, but I'm relatively familiar with it because I was on the planning board for much of this, and we were actually, you know, starting to revise it. So I'm okay for now, but I am looking for what that says about build-out. If I find it, I'll let you know.
Great. It was 2007 was the last time we did it, right? I think that's when I was on the planning board. It was part of that process. I remember getting into it quite a bit. So, yeah, it's time to update it. The town has evolved since then, obviously. But I know that people do refer to the master plan all the time in deliberations, specifically on the planning board and some of the other committees. I think Zoning Advisory Committee from time to time references the master plan and how things should be aligned to. So I think it's good work. It's useful for the community, and I'm excited to see it move forward. Mr. Kamal.
Through the chair, first off, I really want to commend the planning board and staff for the exceptional effort that they put in preparing this document. Other communities I've worked for, usually the town hires a consultant to do the work, and the price tag is pretty substantial. So good work, good effort, good product. I'm also encouraged by the approach that the planning board used. Normally, these land use master plans focus on land use issues. The planning board has taken its approach to developing the master plan to the next level. Namely, they have focused on non-traditional land use components or elements. Specifically, there's a chapter that addresses governance. I commend the planning board for its effort in that regard. I want the planning board, I actually want to encourage the planning board to, in fact, provide more guidance in terms of that topic. The the section as currently written seems to emphasize the independence of boards. We like that, it's great. But by the end of the day, we're always looking for a one town, one solution. I would like the planning board to review the collaboration that will help this community move forward. If there are any constraints that they've identified in past years, this is the time to talk about that. So again, one time, one solution. Let's talk more about collaboration. I respect the independence of the boards. And this, in my mind, let's use this opportunity to celebrate the independence of the board, of the boards in town as a mechanism that still allows for collaboration. Second piece, implementation. In my discussions, preliminary discussions with Elaine, the planning board is going to continue to work on this topic. I think it's important that they identify who's responsible for what and what it will take to get the job done, which then brings me to the third piece. Again, this is a land use master plan, but we all know getting things to move forward does cost money. It may be helpful for the planning board to identify from a big picture perspective how these initiatives will be funded. So those are my three points. Let's celebrate the independence of the boards within the context of how do we collaborate to move forward. Let's identify the implementation process, and then finally, if there are things that really need to move forward, how will they be funded?
I think you raise an interesting question and one I was thinking about from a different angle. You know, the master plan obviously has to work in concert with and in coordination with other, you know, in the planning board, and they do, but other town boards and committees in the community, in our local government, but also within the confines and guidance and expectations of the town charter. So we can't have the master plan say, well, the boards can do this, this, and this, and the town charter says the boards are going to do that, that, and that. You know, so that has to, we got to make sure that they're aligned. And so what I was thinking about before you made your comments, Mr. Kamala, which I think are spot on, is to what extent can or should the charter and the charter review committee take the master plan process into account and incorporate some of that, not the master plan itself, but the expectation of the master plan process product being a guide for the community as it moves forward. I don't know if you can do that. I think that's a question for Mr. Mieres and whether that's appropriate or not in a town charter and whether the legislature in Boston would smile or frown based on it coming before them in that manner. But I just think it's an interesting thought to consider based on what you described, Mr. Kahlo, but also what I'm thinking in terms of making sure it has some teeth to it to some extent. You know, we spend a lot of time and a lot of energy and a lot of good thought, a lot of experience goes into that master plan process. Are we really following it as much as we should, and can we put a little teeth into it by thinking about the charter and the master plan? So I just throw that out there for consideration. Mrs. Wright, page 15, I believe, has the...
Two things. To your point, I mean, always bearing in mind that we can write any old plan that we want. Much of what we're talking about when we are talking about land use comes down to private ownership and private individuals' rights to develop their land as they see fit. And so, it's good to have an overall vision and an overall objective, but all of us who've been on planning board knows that at the end of the day, you know, landowners come to you, they have a right to use the land in the way they wish, and, you know, we can hope and pray that that's going to fit with our overall objective. We have certain constraints in how much teeth we can put into the management of how the land actually gets developed. We can work on it through zoning things and stuff, but, you know, I guess having spent as many years as I have on planning board and people saying, oh, you should be doing this, you should be that, and I'm always frustrated with that sort of lack of acknowledgement that, you know, the private property owner in our country is paramount in how land gets used. So there are some constraints. That's all I'm
I think that's true in our country. I'm not sure that's true in Massachusetts, frankly. I think Massachusetts is far more aggressive in what people can and can't do much to my chagrin at times, based on what other things go on in our Commonwealth. But anyway, that's probably a debate for another day or discussion for another day.
But I did notice the land use, the vacant land, by the way, except I just lost it. Where was it? It was here a minute ago. Here it is. This just says vacant residential land. Vacant residential land. Hopkinton has 2,659 acres of vacant privately owned land zoned for residential use. About half of the acres in these parcels have severe development constraints. So, you know, maybe.
So that leaves 1,300
of relatively good development land. So anyway, just throwing that out since we talked about it earlier on.
So if you kind of do very rough numbers, it's a good pickup. 1,300 acres, let's say it's an acre or a lot,
people. Most residential is 60,000.
There's 5,000 people right there. We're at 17. There's your 22, 24, something like that. I mean, that's it can vary.
Work with.
It's
but
there.
So. Again, to my earlier point, there is a limit in the amount of land that's available and a limit in the amount of growth at a certain point the town's going to be able to support. So not today, but going forward in a few years, at some point our town planning will have to factor in, you know, how much growth can we realistically expect can happen in the town.
Right.
I was just happy to see that the that it opened with Hopkinton's overarching vision. That took a little over a year with a lot of insight as the basis, because that's something that just came up just last year, the way people are thinking of how they want their town to look in the future and how they want the town thought of.
Okay. Anybody else? Any other input at this point? When do we need to finalize any input coming from the board?
I think the public hearing number 21st would be best to have that.
Okay. So if anybody has any ideas they want to submit through the town manager's office to go, it's probably best that we send those in individually. I don't think the board necessarily has to take a position on all these different issues, because that could be a long and painstaking process. But I think as individuals, people can submit their ideas, right? Is that
that's
kind
right.
of I think that's the approach to go. Everybody good? All set? Okay, so with that, we'll close that item for this evening and move on to the next item, the 2017 item number 8 on the agenda, the 2017 Boston Marathon Invitational Entry Program. The Board of Selectmen will consider approving categories that will be allocated for invitational entries and seek requests from organizations within each category that wish to receive funds raised by the invitational entries for the 2017 Boston Marathon. In effect, we get a certain number of numbers from the Boston Athletic Association as part of our coordinated effort to bring forward this world-class event, not only to Hopkinton and Boston, but to Massachusetts and the country. What we had done in recent years, for those of us that are new, but you've probably seen this before, perhaps, we have what boils down to a raffle or a drawing of sorts to allocate the numbers in a fair and equitable way to the organizations that submit requests to the board through the town manager's office to get access to those numbers. The Boston Marathon Charity Program, which I'm familiar with, puts a value on the expectation or puts a number, the expected value of the bib and what it can raise, quote, in the marketplace, between $4,000 and $5,000. So it's a very substantial, you get dozens of these things, opportunity for the community and the organizations within the community to raise funds. We just try to manage it in a way. In years past, the numbers were coming to the community and they were sort of getting doled out in different manners, and it was somewhat disorganized and not necessarily controlled. And given the dollar value that these things command, this prior board's got involved. So organize it in a better fashion. Mr. Kamala, anything else?
I think well said, Brian.
So what do you want to do tonight?
Specifically, per the town's marathon policy, there are, I believe, two decision points.
The first decision by the board is to identify the categories of groups that the board will invite applications for invitational entries. And in the past, the board has considered basically two categories: organizations undertaking public service activities for the benefit of the town of Hopkinton as the first category. That includes town departments by definition. And then two, organizations undertaking public service activities within and for the benefit of the town of Hopkinton. I think by way of history, initially the board was looking nationwide for organizations that benefit the community. That discussion went down to the state level, and then the last 2 years the focus was on organizations from Hopkinton, and in fact that decision was based on the success of the program locally, and also the desire to make sure that the invitational entries benefit Hopkinton community.
So for the benefit of the new members and perhaps others watching the meeting, what was the amount, total amount, approximate total amount that the numbers we oversaw last year, what was the amount raised?
Approximately $256,000.
$256,000.
And that all came to whichever charity. So, for example, if you decide to run for, you win one of these lotteries and you say, I'm going to run for, maybe it's Bay Path Humane Society, or maybe it's the Ambulance Fund, or maybe it's whatever. If you raise $5,000, does that go to that charity? 100% of that?
So we don't through this process pick the runners to get the bib. We distribute the numbers equitably to the organizations who then go and get the runners. You'd be surprised how many organizations get a number or two and then have to go find somebody that'll actually do the running and do the fundraising as part of that process. But we focus on the organizations and the distribution, equitable distribution of the numbers.
Well, I have two questions. One, each year it seems the amount of money expected to be raised has gone up and up and up. Now it's 5,000 this year. Last year, for that figure you quoted, what was the amount they had to raise? Because I remember just a couple years ago it was 2,500.
So they don't have to raise that amount. They're expected to raise that amount.
Looked in here like they had to agree to it.
Yes, we offer that number as a guideline. We're also leveraging the success in fundraising by some of the organizations in town. What I mean by that is there are organizations in town that do this work very well. And we are asking new organizations that come up to liaise with these established organizations in two areas, namely how to put together a successful fundraising program, and then two, how to identify runners, because by the end of the day, you need to have runners. So what we have heard from some of these very successful organizations in town is that they can meet that number very easily.
So was the number last year 5,000 or was it less?
I'll have to check my notes. I may have been 4,500.
That's what I thought it was.
Yeah, I think, and the BAA has established this through the charity program goals and what they believe the participation in a marathon can generate if done properly. So it's, again, they don't say you must raise $4,000 or $5,000 to make this happen, because once you issued the number, you got the number, and that's it. They can't take it back if you don't raise funds. What we did at the conclusion of last year's marathon is we got a report from the town manager of how well the organizations that were distributed numbers did. And across the board, everyone did very well, I thought, reasonably well. You know, some of the organizations are new, some are old, some have done it 27 years, some have done it 1 year. So you kind of get a better feel based on some experience. Mrs. Wright.
In fact, through the chair, the number last year was 5,000.
I was just wondering how many numbers we anticipated on having this year, and I do notice it in the invitational entry application process that was submitted. It says organizations organizations who apply commit to a minimum of raising $5,000. I know a few years ago the Historical Society had a number, and we had a runner who didn't come anywhere near raising what she was supposed to raise, and they ended up going out to their membership and asking everybody to make contributions so that they could meet their minimum, which gave me the impression that, you know, if you don't raise it, you have to come up with it somewhere. But I was just wondering how many we expect to have this year and if we've had trouble getting that amount raised.
Mr. Kamal.
In terms of the number that the town will receive this year, we expect to receive no less than what the town received last year, which was 50.
15?
50, 50.
50.
Yes.
50.
And just very basic math off last year, 250K, 50 numbers, 5, right, somewhere around there. I can tell you there are other charitable organizations whose average per number is closer to $9,000. But they've been around for a long time and are very well organized and very committed to the process. Anything else, Mr. Kamal, on this topic?
Yes, again, it's a two-part request, the first request being the board identifying the categories of organizations to apply, and then the second ask is authorization from the board to send the notice out. As you can see from the document that was included in your packet, our goal is to make this announcement as early as tomorrow, and then have the responses submitted to the Board of Selectmen's office by noon on Friday, November 22nd, and then have the board conduct the lottery or the distribution of the numbers at its first or second December meeting.
So are we doing anything with this policy statement tonight?
That's one of the questions. Do we want to basically really fine-tune this to Hopkinton organizations? We've slowly been coming in that direction, and I think that's the fundamental question before us.
Yes.
We'd definitely say yes to that.
Okay, so there's one. We're straw polling here just a little bit. So, you know what I mean, Todd? So years ago we started with, okay, if it's a charitable organization in the United States of America, it's a 501c3, and blah, blah, blah.
And we didn't give any to anybody outside of Massachusetts.
Right. And then we didn't go outside of Massachusetts, but we did go outside of Hopkinton a little bit, because I recall one of the charitable organizations that came to us was not a Hopkinton-funded or founded organization, operated out of Hopkinton. We gave them a couple numbers. But over the years, that slowly, Hopkinton is a great community with a lot of organizations that are out there doing good works that need fundraise to keep their machines going or keep their efforts under going. So we have a lot of it going on just in Hopkinton. So I think the fundamental question is, do we really want to try to zero it in the Hopkinton-based organizations?
Okay, but this policy statement covers a lot more than that.
That's correct.
So that's something we're going to discuss.
So we're trying to fine-tune that tonight with the question, yeah.
Okay.
Yes.
Could you explain number 5 for me in the policy statement then, please? Non-monetary payments and other benefits.
Oh, yeah. Todd. If you're referring to the general policy, that's not under discussion tonight.
That's not under discussion.
Yes, that policy that has been established.
Okay.
Yeah. What's under discussion is the notice that we
sent out. Last year, we used these same three categories. Benefits, undertakes activities for benefit of Hopkinton, undertaking public service within the town of Hopkinton, and undertake public service activities within Commonwealth. Do you have the breakdown of how many we had within each category for what we granted?
How many applications or how many we granted?
How many we granted? So we granted numbers to organizations. Each organization fell within one of those three categories. How many did we grant within each category?
If I remember correctly, it may have been 29 for the lottery and the remainder to town organizations. I don't have a specific number here.
Okay.
Yeah.
And again, I think the one that we're most concerned with is item D, undertaking public service activities within the Commonwealth, right?
Correct.
That's the one that is under consideration to squeeze out. Do we know how many fell into that category and what the organization or organizations were?
In terms of applications we received or waivers granted?
That we granted.
I don't believe we included anything in that category.
I thought that there was one or two that we considered, but we didn't grant it to them.
Yeah. In years past.
Yeah.
Well, Mrs. Wright.
To Mr. Sestari's point, can we reasonably expect that we may get 50 applications out of Hopkinton-specific organizations, or can we prioritize, make those two our priority with an escape clause that in the event that a sufficient number
and that's what we've always we've always done that.
That Commonwealth of Massachusetts is the fallback position, only if we can't receive that. Can we reasonably expect on previous experience that we could get 50 for Hopkinton?
50, I don't know.
Well, one thing to consider is that it's not all 50 that we're granting. There's a bunch that go to various department heads to distribute.
Okay.
So as Mr. Kamala said,
public safety in particular.
Last year we had 29 to distribute.
Okay, so 50 is the wrong number,
But I understand. Yeah. And when you allow them to request up to five, then without question, everybody, last year actually it was surprising. We had a few that didn't request five, but we'll definitely have requests for more than 29.
Yeah.
Based on a couple of emails I've received already about this topic this year, I think we will likely be able to fill with quality organizations the numbers in the community. And if we can't, then we could always bump it out to the region, Metro West and out to the state. But most likely, I think we will fill with what we have for needs in Hopkinton, those that we will be making available for that approach. So, to try and move this along a little bit, if that's okay, the chair will entertain a motion to have the Boston Marathon Invitational Charity program focused on Hopkinton-based organizations first and foremost, with any excess numbers then going to a regional or state organization.
So moved. Second.
Is that motion in line with your thinking, Mr. Kamala, for getting us better organized?
I think if the board is so inclined, you may want to use the language identified in the notice that we shared with the board, specifically organizations undertaking public service activities for the benefit of the town of Hopkinton being one group, and then the next group being organizations undertaking public service activities within and for the benefit of the town of Hopkinton.
I thought I said that. Mr. Catino, was that in your motion?
Yeah, exactly. And then working away.
And that's in the second?
Yes.
Everybody good? Any discussions on the motion? Everybody good? All those in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So we'll proceed with that set of guidelines.
Okay. Thank you.
Okay. Item number 9 on the agenda, and let me just back up for a minute here. And then we'll look forward for a minute. Mr. Kamala.
Number 9, simply added this on the agenda, Brian, for the board's attention that
this... Let me just introduce it. This is the center school disposition process. The Board of Selectmen will discuss the process to review the potential future uses for the center school property that may be feasible when, upon the closure of the school committee determines that the property is no longer needed or required for educational purposes. This is not only something that we need to do at the local level, this is something that the MSBA expects that we will do based on the funding coming from the state as well. Mr. Kamala.
Correct. And in terms of background, in addition to Mr. Hess's points, I want the board also to recall that, in fact, there is a committee that was established many years ago, Ellen. When the the failed school vote went through, there was a committee established to look into this topic. So what I'm looking for today is whether the board would like staff to begin looking into whether to resuscitate that committee or to develop a new charge for a committee that the board can discuss at a future meeting.
So let's take this in two parts.
Yeah.
First, I think we want to make sure that we're all on the same page and the community understands that, you know, many of us had the opportunity to go to the school building groundbreaking the other day, mud breaking as the case may be. Yeah. Pretty funny. It was pretty muddy there, but it was a great event, really nice event. We're building a new school. And as part of that process, as part of the regulation and the funding that we get from the MSBA and everything else, the disposition of the existing school is a requirement, and we have already had to submit to the MSBA our thoughts on how we would begin that process and that we would go undertake a process specific to the disposition of the center school itself. So I just want to make sure we're all clear about that. And the community understands this is part of a process that we are obligated to go forward and study. That's not to say we're going to do anything necessarily, but we have to, or anything dramatic. It just means we have to do something. Okay, we just can't let it sit there and rot because that's not helping the Commonwealth or the town either. So is everybody okay with that piece of the puzzle for now anyway? Right, it's our charge and responsibility to get into this and sort it out. Everybody good? Okay, so with that, then the next question that Mr. Kamalo poses, and I think a good one and one we should consider, and I don't know if we have to discuss it and finalize it tonight. I probably would not suggest that we do so because I think we want to chew on this a little bit. We did have a committee appointed for the disposition of the center school years ago when the concept was around school districting and doing the thing at Elmwood and doing the new school in Fruit Street and so forth. That didn't pan out. And as part of the process then, the MSBA said, what are you going to do with center school? And we put a committee together, and that committee started looking at it and so forth. But then obviously stalled because nothing really happened. What is the board's thoughts on, do we want to try to revitalize that, or do we want to start up anew with a new committee, basically with the same charge? I think that's the fundamental question that we need to consider, not necessarily tonight and finalize, but consider for a period of time here. Is that a fair summation?
Yes, it is.
Okay. So, just initial thoughts. Let's not get into the weeds just yet on the school and the color of the brick or anything else. Let's just figure out sort of the general concept of what do you think about, you know, how we should move forward. Mr. Tedstone.
Is the committee that you spoke of still together? Is it still intact, or has that been disbanded?
I don't believe it was ever officially disbanded. I don't recall. I mean, that's kind of a short vote if it did disband. I think it just died a natural death, like everything else at that time. My sense is that those that stepped forward to help then were passionate then about the issues in front of the community and what we were doing to move forward. Whether they're still engaged, whether they're still in town, who knows? So my sense is we need to kind of restart this whole process with new people and a new charge, but I don't think it was disbanded technically.
And the committee that was put together, is that made of townspeople, or is that made of department heads, or a mix of both? Or?
Yeah, I think we set up a whole process. Mr. Kamal.
Yeah, it was a mix of both.
Yeah. Like we would set a committee for most things. We try to bring in various expertise from the community, including professional team members, volunteer team members, interested citizens. You know. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, that's.
I'm sorry. Are you good for right now?
Yep,
for initial input.
Yeah, that's where I stood. You know, who's still left from that committee, but to put a fresh one together with fresh objectives based upon the objectives we had previously would be favorable to me.
Okay, Mrs. Wright.
Yeah, I think a lot has changed. The different time, different needs. We might as well start fresh. Totally different project. We're not looking at a school, we're looking at a not school, or some of the uses, maybe school uses, using that gym or whatever. So I think we should start fresh. Since that Fruit Street school vote failed, I think the town has done a much better job
of understanding that we need to get community input, community buy-in. Joe Markey did an outstanding job of community engagement in moving that new elementary school project forward. He really, that was a model for how we should do things. And, I looked at the first page of this Irving Todaro plan that was just presented, and really, I think this lays out exactly what we should be doing for Center School. Design an interactive public process, develop a development plan, ensure it reflects the community's aspirations, provide an assessment of the broader neighborhood context, the appropriateness of the particular uses on the site, taking into consideration the quality of life and the visual characteristics in the area as valued by the community. This is the center of the historic district, the old school building is, so the visual characteristics and the neighborhood context is very important. Create a plan, get input from a broad base of citizens, and conduct public education and outreach on the development plan. I mean, this is exactly what we should be doing, and it's good that we're starting early. We should really bring in a lot of different stakeholders and kick around ideas for using the whole site. I think starting fresh and engaging the community is exactly the way to go. I think this is a great outline for what we should be doing.
Okay. Mr. Sestari.
Mr. Kamala, what are the, restrictions on what this committee can do prior to the school actually being there, the property being turned over to the town from the schools?
In fact, to answer your question in a more roundabout way, Brian, in our intro, I think what we wanted to say was the fact that in the spirit of one town, one solution, we've also reached out to Kathy, who is requesting the school committee to actually take a vote that will authorize this process to move forward, even prior to the new school being completed. Specifically, what needs to happen, to answer the question directly now, what needs to happen is for the school to be the new school to be constructed, and then the school committee takes a vote whether to declare Center School surplus property or not. When that happens, the property then comes under the care and control of the selectmen. And at that point, then the selectmen can lead the process for planning for the school to move forward. So again, clearly, the school is constructed. The school committee votes to declare Center School surplus property. Center School reverts to the control and care of the selectmen, and the planning process begins. However, what we have asked Kathy to do is to allow the process to proceed even before this completion of the new center, new elementary school.
Currently, the targeted opening for the new school is 2018?
September.
Yes, yeah. September 2018.
Yes. Yes.
Okay. Yeah. Okay, so we have about 2 years, which I'm not suggesting we slow down, because this is the kind of thing that there's going to be a lot of opinions to go through and a lot of options also. We're probably also going to be a little bit limited in some of the things that we can do, I guess, or explore, given the fact that there are still students in the building. So it would, it would prohibit, different groups getting opinions from possibly groups outside the municipality to go in and give their opinions or anything like that. But
we can't go in and start doing core shots of the foundation to see what it's like while there's kids in
the Yeah. But nonetheless, yeah, I think that, I mean, it makes all the sense in the world to get started on this as early as we can, and just be very thorough about it, right?
This is right.
Yeah, I mean, it's completely unacceptable to have to wait until they're ready to, until they have the new school built before they sign off on it. It certainly seems that can be worded in such a way that it's contingent upon the school being ready, but the last thing you want is to have an unused, unoccupied building for any longer period than necessary. So I would, and it sounded like Mr. Kamali was saying that, that there are ways to arrange that that would free us up to start doing some serious planning for not only the building, but the land in back, for the extension, for the gymnasium. We don't want to wait until we're ready to go into the new school before we can start taking some concrete, no pun intended, steps, planning steps for that whole site.
Correct.
So that can be wordsmithed in such a way to allow real planning to start happening.
In fact, that's the request we have put forth to Kathy. To discuss with the school committee some form of authorization for the selectmen to commence this work as soon as possible.
Yeah, I think the sooner that we engage not only ourselves but the community in this mm-hmm. process, the better. To your point earlier about Joe Markey and the elementary school building committee, and that's kind of what I talked about the other day in the collaboration that the vice chair mentioned to me as well. You know, we're going to have a great product on Hayden Row in this new elementary school because we had a great process. And if we have a really good process with the center school disposition, I think we can end up with a great result there as well. We don't have a million options here. I mean, it's either a public entity that continues in some form or fashion with the town's input, control, and guidance, or it is sold to a private developer, or it is and I'm not saying this is what I want to do, or is taken down and that land is reused for something entirely different. I mean, those are your options, really. So we want to figure out what's the best option for the community, what's the best option financially for the community, but there's a lot of work in that, and I think the sooner we get going on it, the better. So with that, if you could keep us apprised, or maybe perhaps inform our colleagues at the school committee, we are interested in trying to get a head start or at least get going on. We've got to follow MSBA guidelines. We don't want to put anything at risk there in terms of their support for the project, which I don't think we would. But let's make sure that they know the sooner the better would be ideal. Because it is in a very sensitive area of town in terms of its historic significance in the community, the building itself, as well as the district that it sits in.
Okay.
Okay. Anything else? Anybody else? Good for now. Good.
Mm-hmm.
Okay.
It's a protected property, so taking it down is not.
Yeah, I'm not. Again, I'm not. That's not what I'm advocating. I'm just saying.
No, it's not one of the three choices.
Well, parts of it.
But you have to understand, in Hopkinton, there will be people that will come forward and say, "Take it down." Mm-hmm. So we have to be ready for that. So we just got to sort it all out. Mr. Kim, sorry, what was that?
No, it said, well, parts of it could come down.
The rear part, but the front is a historic district property.
All that we'll sort out over time. Okay, so Mr. Kamal, if you could keep us posted on what you hear back from our colleagues, that would be great.
Thank you.
Okay, item number 10, board liaison assignments or invites. Mr. Kamal, do we have any invites come in recent days, or new invites, I should say?
None that I can think of at this point. Yes, there's the Metro West Regional Transit Authority meeting.
Yeah, I'll attend that.
Yeah.
That's dinner. They asked for a speaker.
That's it.
Okay. Mrs. Wright.
Actually, that Veterans Dinner on November 11th at the Rod and Glove at 6, and they asked, would someone from the Board of Selectmen speak? So we might think about that.
Okay. Didn't we?
I'm planning on going to that.
There was an email specific to that. I thought somebody said they were going to attend that event.
I didn't respond back on email, but I'm on that. I'm the liaison to that, and I am planning on going. So.
Okay.
So just to clarify for those that might be watching, the Board of Selectmen does not have any dialogue back and forth specific to any issue that comes before the town or the board. When an invite comes out and we ask logistically who can attend, people will say, I can attend or not. That is the extent of the email dialogue that goes on. I saw where someone was going to be going to that November 11th.
We'll check with Maria. I think the good thing is member Ted Stone is volunteering.
Right.
to represent the board at the event.
I'm out of town, so that's why I thought it was covered. So, okay, any other invite questions? So we do want to make sure we're there.
I go to everything, so I'll probably end up being there anyway.
And John goes to everything, too. So.
You can talk to him.
All right. Liaison assignments. Any liaison reports? Mr. Tedstone.
Nope. Just the that elementary school building committee had that groundbreaking. Most of us were there and very smoothly. And the follow-up meeting will come tomorrow.
Great. Mr. Catino.
And I just had the Irvine Todaro, and you got the report from the chair.
Okay. Mrs. Wright.
Nothing new tonight.
Mr. Sestari.
Just more charter review committee. Continuing to look at things and trying to, start to put together the materials for the public session, the next public session.
Okay. The platform committee, development committee, met recently. I was there, and the discussion about the scout camp and the water future capacity to access the land for water development for wells was discussed. There's some questions that we're trying to sort through, so more to come on that, but that's what the committee's working on right now. There was, there had been a big beaver dam problem right after the purchase was made. It became very apparent. That had been addressed. We talked about that before, I think, on a prior board, prior to this board anyway. That's been addressed, and that seems to be working much better now on the site. But we do want to sort through the scout camp and the future land use for water wells question, which is a significant one for that property. And the town manager is involved in that as well. Also, we did have the elementary school building groundbreaking. I thought that went extremely well. There's a lot of people that attended that event. And then finally, the athletic fields liaison to the school committee's subcommittee on the athletic fields assessment for all the athletic fields within the schools. They've had a couple of presentations, one presentation, another presentation is tomorrow by one of the consultants. I'll be attending that and let you know what comes out.
Is it an appropriate time here to ask where they're leading towards their thought process?
I think it's too early to decide, see which way. And again, I'm a liaison, so I'm not a voting member of that committee. The appropriations has a liaison, and there's one other liaison, and the rest are voting
Parks
members.
Parks and Rec.
So I'd say it's too early probably to tell which way they're leaning. Okay. But that's all I have for liaison from chair seat. Anything else on liaison side? Item number 11, Mr. Kamalo, town manager's report.
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I included in your packet a very brief description of a couple items related to the town's alcohol policy. And what I think may be helpful is for me to set the context for the discussion in terms of 4 points. The first point being on an annual basis, the town renews through following a thorough review process alcohol licenses in town, and the idea here being all reviews are completed by the end of the calendar year. So there is an administrative process that the board has to go through every year. And what we have also learned most recently are the following issues. Number one, under the modernization law, the municipal modernization law passed by Governor Becker, there is a change in the hours of operation for alcohol establishments, specifically with regard to holidays. I am currently reviewing that issue with town council and will be reporting back to the board at a future meeting. Secondly,
We have also learned a couple of things in the past months. Namely, there is an interest in town in establishing, bring your own bottle practices. As we know, in summer, there is an establishment that came through the board, and because we didn't have, the town did not have any regulations for BYOBs, that establishment went in without a license. Related to that is the information that we have also learned relative to opportunities for farmer brewery pouring licenses. We had one license come through in the office in the last month, and we realize we do not have a fee schedule for that license. We're spending a lot of effort and time reviewing the application, and so we're gathering good information in terms of what the town could set as a fee for that type of license. Similarly, if the board is inclined to establish a regulation for BYOBs, we will be required, we'll be asking the board to set up a fee schedule for that license. And so, given the fact that the board will be reviewing the annual license applications in the next month, we felt it was important that the board address any adjustments that are required on the policy immediately. Some of these issues are coming to our attention as we get ready for the renewal process. So specifically, I'm asking the board to look at fee schedule for new licenses that are coming up, to review a draft BYOB policy that I include a new packet. And then thirdly, based on some of the recent violation issues that the board dealt with, I also proposed a camera policy for the board's consideration. Any questions in terms of the background?
I read the policy, but the letter from the attorney in regards to those cameras, and it's a good idea that the video is going to be, sounds like it's going to be pretty simple to get in. The audio sounds like it might be a little cost prohibitive, but we can certainly shoot for it.
In fact, that's one of the driving reasons behind my request that the board hold a public hearing, realizing that it might be costly installing some of the equipment. So we want to give the establishments in town the opportunity to give their input.
Mm-hmm. Related to this, but not directly, we had an applicant that you mentioned for the farmer's pouring license.
Yes.
I thought we needed to take action on that prior to November 10th.
It was extended.
It was extended.
Yes.
They extended it. Okay, I just wanted to make sure of that. Secondly, when we voted on the regulations that are effective January 1, we realized that there are one or two establishments that would be affected by the Sunday restrictions. Have we notified those establishments so that they're not blindsided when we send the new licenses out?
No, we have not at this point. What we wanted to do was to get a sense from the board as to whether the board would entertain making the additional hours of operation adjustments ahead of the renewal process. So in other words, rather than us sending one set of hours now and then changing the hours of operation 3 weeks from now, mm-hmm. We felt that it would be helpful for us to send one set of hours of operation.
Okay.
Yeah.
This is right.
So as far as fee structures that we don't have in place, perhaps we could look to surrounding communities to get a sense of what they charge as a guideline. I was wondering, the current applicant for the farmers market pouring license, where we don't have these structures set up, and that's an open application, whether we establish one, can we charge charge that, or have we used the opportunity to apply to start that?
We can charge, because when the application came in, we did consult with the APCC for guidance, and the applicant understands that that's an open issue.
Okay, so yeah. We won't lose that revenue. We just need to figure out what we should be charging.
Correct.
I don't have a strong opinion on the license fee piece of that puzzle you laid out there. I mean, I think you've got to be reasonable. I'm sure there's precedent out there all over Massachusetts, so we just got to do whatever it is we got to do. I guess I would just encourage town council to be front and center on that, to just say this is what we think you should do based on, you know, what else is around and what we can do. And then specific to the hours being adjusted, and specific to the BYOB question, and specific to the farmer's pouring permit, I mean, I think it makes sense to put all that into our policy and have it ready for January 1. And again, you know, I just kind of look at town council and make us reasonable and within, you know, and following Mass General laws specific to an ABC guidelines.
I think we should be looking to town council to come up with any other permutations and license types that we should be considering as well, so we can get out in front of them.
Yeah.
This is the second one that's come up in 6 months that we didn't discuss. One of them, knowingly, I think we intentionally, we said, no, we don't have to deal with this yet. We don't have any. So that was our own issue. But, it'd be nice if there's another one or five or whatever, that we're at least aware of it and we can make a conscious decision, rather, whether or not to discuss it.
And my initial input is agreeing with the town council about oral part of the recording the audio. I believe that that could be problematic, and we should probably drop that part and just go for the videotaping.
So if I could just challenge a little bit on that. I mean, one of the reasons that we had an incident take place where it was fairly obvious to everybody that studied it that there was a serious issue there, but because we didn't have the audio, nothing's going to happen.
We didn't have the video either. We had still pictures.
No.
Well, it's considered video, but it's antiquated video.
Yeah, right. Okay. It's the audio, I think, that would have made all the difference in the world. So I personally think that if you're going to do video, you might do audio. This is 2016. I mean, you know, they can listen to us from space talking right now. Why we wouldn't understand if someone's coming in and slurring their words and then some establishment is selling them alcohol, I just don't think is appropriate. Technology's there. It's used all over the state. It's used all over the country. Why isn't it used in Hopkinton?
Yeah, and there are plenty of solutions out there that are cloud-based and somewhat reasonably priced, and, you know, it's the cost of doing business.
I should explore. I'm not, you know, we're not voting tonight on it.
No.
But I think that we should, at the very least, explore the idea of putting not only better video, I guess, but audio into the mix.
Right. But
if I may, through the chair, I want to recognize the police chief's presence here. He has been part of these discussions. Also, in terms of the fee schedule, by law, the fee has to be based on what it costs the town to process the application. However, to your point, Maria is already seeking information from other towns on what they charge. We usually follow a two-step process. First step being we cost the process in terms of what the town charges, and then we reference the data from the other towns just to validate and see where the market is. But our primary focus is in costing the process.
Speaking to the video and the audio, the cost incurred for that does go to the business owner, correct?
Correct.
See, my objection to it, it's just based on that it has to be a sign saying audio and video recording. And, you know, it could keep people from wanting to frequent that liquor store.
But they'll all have it.
Right, but to Ray's point, it's unclear how much benefit an audio recording requirement can achieve, especially if video cameras are also required. There are likely few instances, mostly involving service to intoxicated persons, where an audio recording would capture an illegality that the video camera would miss.
We just had one.
No, but that was because we didn't have the video.
I love Ray. I think he's wrong. Yeah. And I think we should talk to him about that.
The police chief is here too?
If the person has nothing to hide, then they won't worry about going in there.
Yep.
It's my understanding that in certain cases, the ABCC has said, well, we can't hear whether they're slurring their speech or not, so therefore they're not, therefore they didn't, therefore they didn't do what obviously happened. So, I mean, we see those signs all the time. Every phone call you ever get now, this is being recorded, be aware. I mean, it's everywhere. I don't think we're going to be overly aggressive.
But we're discussing this another night, right?
Yeah.
You know, Ray's objection seems based on his concerns that it was complicated or it would be hard to synchronize the audio with the video to validate that, you know, things went together. But it certainly seems as if the technical abilities out there now are
really, really expanded. I think it would be worth looking into what the technical requirements really are.
Let's do this. I think there's some valid points on both sides of the question that have been made very well. Let's just let town council know, specific to the audio and video, the board, some of the board has concerns, so we'd like to explore it further and better understand it, and discuss it and make some decisions at a future date, like the next couple of meetings.
Yeah, I'm libertarian.
Without getting into political philosophy, I just think we'll table it for now, but you know, I just said it. I think town council's wrong on this one, but you know, whatever. Let's talk about it further and bring it back at our next meeting or the week after that, or the meeting after that. Okay? But it'd be nice to have this sorted out and us take some position on it prior to the new policy going into effect January 1 on all these questions, including the audio and video.
What were the I wasn't on the board when you guys did the liquor license. Todd said that there's a couple of establishments that's going to be compromised by Sundays.
Yeah.
What else?
We have a later time in the morning that they're able to start serving alcohol.
Okay.
So I think it's the Country Club.
Country Club.
And Cornell's?
Cornell's, I believe.
Yeah. Yeah. I think those are the two that are affected. And I forget, did we say that by special request the permit could be, or the license could be altered?
The time could be altered by a specific request, such as Thanksgiving Day in advance of, you know, sort of those types of things.
Yeah.
And New Year's Eve, I think, was the other one. No, that's on the closing side. That was okay.
I think there was concern for the Country Club, for the brunches that they do, and things like that.
So a lot of this, I think, kind of goes back to town council, making sure that we're on the, you know, straight and narrow with Mass General Law and the ABCC, but also that we're consistent in our policies with our fees, and that we look at these couple of other questions in advance of our January 1 startup. Okay?
Great.
Does that make sense?
Makes sense. Again, I think in terms of the video and the audio, we have local expertise through the police department. They use this tool regularly, and I'll have the police chief and Ray debate the issue before the next Board of Selectmen meeting.
Ray's very good at debating.
Yeah.
Yeah. Fairly open-minded.
Yeah.
So is the police chief.
Okay. Chief, so Chief, you're going to work that one with the town manager?
Chief has a gun.
Yeah. Yeah. All right, so with that, Mr. Kamal, you had an FY18 budget calendar update item as well?
Yeah, just sharing with the board that I have since received input from the Appropriations Committee regarding
at least making sure that the dates that we have in the calendar line up with the projected special town meeting for the charter review process, as well as the public hearing that have been scheduled for that process.
Okay.
Yeah.
So talk a little bit about the projected special town meeting dates, because I think there's a lot of expectations out there, at least amongst those that are active in looking at the charter situation and a couple other questions, but we really have not gotten into that at all. So that's just pure speculation. Is that a fair statement?
Yes.
Okay. So I would just caution all of us in the community to let us play this out a little bit before we get too far down a path as to when the special town meeting will take place, because we want to make sure we're ready and we don't really have that direct guidance yet that we're ready to go. Okay. Anything else on the calendar update?
No.
All right. Future board agenda items. Mr. Sestari?
Nothing.
Mr. Tedstone?
No, nothing for me.
Mrs. Wright?
Not tonight.
Mr. Catino?
Still looking into parking.
Still looking into parking.
A separate from the 25% to 50% and the 100% of the changeover in the town.
Yeah. Again, as we've explained before, we're hoping that when staff brings back the current designs of the Main Street Corridor project, that we will address the parking issue. As we're continuing to explore opportunities, and at this point, I also believe the project creating additional parking spaces at the police station will be moving forward soon, which is great. We also, I think as we learned when we made the last presentation to the chamber, that the parking spaces created along Claflin, as well as parking spaces created to support 42 Main Street, are now an additional benefit to the downtown area. There are other opportunities that I've discussed offline with Elaine. I just do get the time to act on them.
Okay. So, I mean, it's not on the agenda for tonight, but I understand the concern about parking in downtown, and whether it's a specific item on the agenda or a very specific topic of discussion as part of another agenda item specific to downtown, it will be coming up soon. Okay?
Right.
Mrs. Wright.
Just one question for Mr. Kamala. At this point, what is the projected opening date for the North Road? Because it seems to me that a lot of our discussions around downtown and traffic, that road is intended to take pressure off the downtown, and it's hard to get a sense of some of these issues till we see what the impact is. Do you know when that's going to be open?
Should be soon. Based on my last discussions with staff, there were still some punchline items that still need to be addressed. Elaine, do you have any more?
That's all I know.
Yeah.
We have not accepted that road yet, correct?
No, we have not. The town has not.
Until it's done and everything's... When would we accept that, though?
A couple of years from now.
So it'll be a couple years out? All that other work is done? Okay, got it.
Well, I mean, the addition of all that housing will impact the traffic and its use as well. But just the fact, once it's open, you know, how it affects that 85-135 intersection at peak hours yet remains to be seen. So I just was curious, because that all enters into all these discussions about traffic and parking in the downtown.
I said punchline. Punch list items, and I'll check with staff in terms of the expected time for resolving those items and what the projected opening for the road is. Yeah.
Okay. Anything else for future board agenda items?
No, but Mr. Chair, on the subject of punch lines, I just want to remind people that next Tuesday is election day, and whether or not people feel as though their vote makes a difference in Massachusetts, there are a lot of items that are down ballot races, as well as other ballot initiatives. And I'd just like to urge all the voters in Hopkinton to get out and use your right.
Great. I have voted myself already. With that, any other topics?
Mr. Just one quick thing. I'd like to mention that a longtime resident of Hopkinton, who she and her husband dedicated a huge part of their life, passed away this week, Doris Cumlin. Mm. And she worked in the library forever. Her husband, Cook. Not many people around here know him or her. But she passed away this week. I think it's worthy of being mentioned that when we lose people like that from the town that have been here for a long time, it's at the very least we can do is mention them. And that's my thought there.
Absolutely. Thank you for doing so.
To Mr. Ted Stone's point, Lynn Fournier as well, who served for many, many years, chairman of the Cemetery Commission, also commissioner of the trust funds, just recently passed. So she served the town for many years and want to acknowledge that and publicly say thank you for her service as well.
Thank you. With that, the chair will entertain a motion to adjourn.
Second.
Discussion. All those in favor?
Aye.
Thank you. Have a great night, everybody.